Gentlemen, welcome to the Marcellus webinar. So this is a special webinar from us in the sense that we are not discussing today any product or group of product or the event surrounding our portfolio stocks. Rather, we are actually discussing an important aspect of our investment process, that is forensic accounting. So most of us, you must have heard about us discussing the forensic accounting, but we thought that it will be, we should have a dedicated webinar on this topic, given the importance of this topic. So here we are. So we'll start with the, so this is like the summary of the things that we are going to discuss today. So as most of you, would have been aware that primarily we look for three things when we select the stocks. The first and foremost is the clean corporate governance and accounting quality. Then second, we want companies with prudent capital allocation. And third is the company should have strong entry barriers and dominance. So as you see that the first thing which we look out is the clean corporate governance and accounting quality. So that is the first and foremost thing that we look out. So if any company doesn't cross that barrier of clean corporate governance and accounting quality, we don't go to the second and third bullet point. And we will explain the rationale why this accounting quality comes first and foremost in our research process. And looking at the bottom part of the chart, so again, like we have discussed this in multiple forums. So broadly, the Marcellus research process is divided into two parts. So one is the quantitative frameworks, and the which helps us narrow down the universe considerably to a very narrow subset. So I think in case of Nitil Champs and Coffee Can, after we run our quantitative frameworks, we are left with only say 5 to 10%. So Tej will talk about the Kingston Capital separately. So essentially, the quantitative screen helps us narrow down the universe substantially to a narrow set. And on that narrow set, actually, we go into the deep dive diligence. So here, we do the forensic bit in three parts. So one is the screen itself. So we have a forensic accounting screen where we use a set of 12 accounting ratios in case of non-financials and 11 ratios in case of financials to rank the companies on their accounting quality. And we eliminate the companies which fall lower down the rankings so that we have a special screen for forensic itself. And again, the companies which pass through this screen, the narrow set of companies which we have, we go into deep dive diligence. So this is the number of companies small, but we go in depth on the financial statements of these companies. So typically we'll look at 10 to 15 years of annual reports, and we look at the ratios typically which are not covered in our quantitative screen. So things like related party transaction, qualitative checks around corporate governance, board quality, etc. So this is the second level where we again look at the forensic of the companies. And last but not the least, forensic also plays an important part in our third party checks or the primary data checks that we do. So while seeking answers from the third party diligence, we not only focus on the business model or the moats of the company, but we also seek answers on the integrity of the promoters. So in essentially, in summary, there are three ways how we check for the forensic. So first is the screen. Second is the deep dive diligence into individual company. And third is at the primary data level. So now I'll hand over to Tej for how to take us through the financials part.
Thanks, Ashwin. So in the financial space as well, the process is pretty similar. So whether it be Kings of Capital or the financial stocks which we own in Little Champs or Consistent Compounders, we follow a similar process. That is, we start off with the larger universe of financial companies. Say in Kings of Capital, we start off with about 9,500 stocks, and about a third of them get eliminated in the first step itself, which is our forensic accounting screen. So because about 35 companies get eliminated over here, and we'll see how we do that. It is a pretty powerful screen, especially to come up with red flags. What is the part of the balance sheet or the P&L that we should focus on? Like Ashwin said, there are 12 accounting ratios for non-financials in our forensic screen. In the financials forensic screen, we have about 11 accounting ratios. Because the balance sheets or the P&L statement of financial companies is a bit different, these 11 ratios are different from the ratios that we use in non-financial companies. Also in financial companies, because these are inherently leveraged businesses, our scrutiny is in fact much higher. It has to be much higher because it can play a pivotal role. Whether a company is following good accounting quality or good accounting practices, whether it's following good corporate governance practices, eventually determines the long-term shareholder returns of the company. Similarly, on step number three, which is bottom-up research and due diligence over here, what we do is that once we've got the red flags which have been highlighted by our forensic score, we go into detail in the annual report. For example, if say we get that treasury income is higher or fee income is higher for a specific NBFC or a bank, then we go in depth in the annual reports which we do during our bottom up research and due diligence. On top of that, apart from doing the annual report reading, what we do is we also do third-party checks. For example, when we do third-party checks for banks or NBFCs, say we visit branches or speak to DSAs, we get to know a lot about the lending practices of these companies. So eventually, we start out with, say, if we start out with 100 companies, we eliminate 35% of these companies by way of our forensic score, and then an additional about 25-30% more when we do our bottom-up research and due diligence. That is why our focus, especially when it comes to financials, is much more intense when it comes to accounting quality, forensics, and primary data checks around the integrity of the promoter. So yeah, over to you, Ashwin. Ashwin, you're on mute.
So yeah, so this is the thing I was talking about, why the forensic evaluation comes first and foremost in our research process, primarily because of a few reasons. The first is very simple. So obviously, whenever we decide on the stock, we decide on the valuation, obviously we are working on the numbers reported by the company. So we may hear the management, we may hear about the stock from third party, but the proof of the pudding is in the numbers that the companies report. So hence, we need to be sure about the numbers which we are analyzing. So if the numbers turn out to be inaccurate or fraud, so the whole edifice of our analysis will go for a toss, and hence our stock fall. And hence the first and foremost reason is that we should be doubly sure about the numbers of the company. So that is a simple logic. The second part is that we think that the sheer number of companies engaging into some sort of accounting manipulation or capital misallocation in India is simply very, very large actually. So why we believe so is simply look at the BSE 500 actually performance. So BSE 500 between December 2009 to December 2010 has delivered 10% earnings, 10% return to shareholders. So nothing great. But beyond going beyond the headline numbers, when we see the BSE 500, and mind you, we are talking about BSE 500, it's a premier index. So it represents the top 500 companies in India by market cap. We are talking about a very well-tracked and premier index. So it churns by almost 10 to 12% per annum. In other words, nearly 50 to 60 companies exit BSE 500 every year. So and when we look at the reason why these companies have exited, it is less to do with the business reason, but more to do with that the numbers that these companies were showing were not true. And as the time goes on, they are not able to dubious numbers gets unraveled. Or the other reason, primary reason is that these companies engage into capital misallocation. So whatever you say, whether it is accounting practices, dubious accounting practices, or the capital misallocation, the bottom line is that they are detrimental to the minority shareholder. And that has been the prime reason why almost 50 to 60 companies every year, they are not able to hold their place in BSE 500 and they go out of the index. And if you compare similar churn in the Western world, say S&P 500, is roughly half that of the BSE 500. So something, there is the sheer number of churn, the quantum of the churn itself says that there is something amiss in the these companies. And not only these companies exit the index, but while they are exiting the index, they result in enormous destruction in the shareholders' wealth. So for example, if you look at the constituents of BSE 500 at December 2009, the companies which we exited, so the constituents which were there in December 2009, and they have exited over the years, they have seen an average decline in their market cap of almost 40%. So forget about giving positive return to the shareholders. They have destroyed wealth to the tune of 40%. So this is a very big number that they have destroyed for their investors. And the last two bullet points here also are very interesting. So very surprisingly, nearly 80% of the BSE 500, again, I'm talking base as December 2009, they have not been able to deliver real returns to the shareholders. By real return, I mean that assuming very conservative that a shareholder expects 12% return on its equity investment. So 80% of the BSE 500 companies have not been able to cross this barrier actually. So that is a big number actually. In other words, only 20% of the BSE 500 companies have been able to deliver any meaningful return to the shareholder. And last but not the least, nearly 50% of the BSE 500 companies have not been able to deliver positive return. So this is a big thing actually. So they 50% of the BSE 500 constituents at December 2009, they have delivered negative shareholder returns over the last 10 years, actually. So this makes us believe that actually India's stock market is sort of a landmine filled with companies. So simple thing is that the portfolio return is not just about finding winners, actually, but a portfolio return is also a function of avoiding the dubious companies. And hence, sheer number of this, the numbers I talked about, it is a very big, and hence we think that avoiding dubious companies is as important as identifying the great companies. And evaluating accounting quality becomes all the more important for small caps and financials. So I'll talk about the small caps and I'll hand over to Tej for financials. So small caps by the nature, actually, if you know that the small caps are dominated by one man, the board of directors of small cap actually is nothing. They are not independent in a true sense. They are actually filled with the relatives and friends of the promoters actually. And thirdly, there is typically in most of the small cap, there is no professional management, so to say. It's again a one-man show. Promoter takes the key decision. And given that there is no adequate oversight, either from an independent, strong, independent board of directors or a professional management, the tendency to engage into fraudulent practices all the more actually. It goes undetected or unquestioned in these companies, and hence we should be extra cautious about accounting quality in case of small caps actually. And this is again manifested in the performance of the BSE small cap. So if you look at the top left hand side table, so in any country actually, the for that matter, logically, small caps are more volatile or riskier as an asset class compared to the large cap and mid cap. So ideally, it is very reasonable to expect a higher return to compensate for the higher risk and volatility in case of small cap. But the BSE small cap performance in India shows a completely different picture actually. So if you look at the return December 09 to December 19 for the BSE small cap, the CAGR has been 6% actually. So forget about giving higher return than BSE 500, which itself actually is a low number, BSE 500 or the Nifty. They have not been able to even meet that number, despite a very high degree, higher degree of standard deviation in BSE small cap. In fact, the BSE small cap rate of 6% is not been able to match even that of the government bond actually. So you're taking almost thrice the risk in BSE small cap, but you're actually not getting even the similar return that of a government bond. So the accounting quality becomes all the more important in case of the small cap investing. And over to you, Tej, for financials.
So in financials as well, what we have seen is that over the past 4-5 years, 70% of financial stocks have destroyed wealth. That is, 70% of financial stocks have given negative returns. Just like in the case of small caps, where over a 10-year period, 50% of them delivered negative returns. The case is very similar in financials as well. So what we have seen is that there is a clear correlation between accounting quality and shareholder returns. So if you look at the chart on the right of the screen, what we have seen is that companies which are in D1, D2 or D3, these are classified as companies in the zone of quality, basis our forensic screen. The way we arrive at this ranking is we use a combination of 11 ratios for financial companies. And basis these 11 ratios, we finally arrive at a ranking. And we compare banks to banks, NBFCs to NBFCs, housing finance companies to housing finance companies, so as to arrive arrive at a ratio by comparing peers with each other rather than comparing apples to oranges. And on the basis of this, these ratios, we have seen that companies which have high quality accounting in the financial space, they are the only ones which have over the past 4-5 years been able to generate positive returns. And as we progressively go down the order in terms of accounting quality, the returns have become even worse. So, for example, companies in the zone of thuggery have returns of anywhere between -10% to -30%, while companies in the zone of quality have returns between +6% to +20%. And therefore, the margin of error in case of financial companies is pretty low. Because these are leveraged businesses, you have to be very careful on not only accounting quality, but also on capital allocation. So that is part one on identifying companies which have poor quality accounting. Another misconception which a lot of investors have is that even if there are companies which have questionable accounting quality or questionable practices, the belief is that you can ride out these companies over a period of time. That is, you can invest in these companies and investors will be able to exit just before the problems in these companies come out. But because in the case of financial companies, these are problems which have been festering for a long period of time, and these are problems in a leveraged business, shareholders do not get a lot of time to react once the problems come out in the public. So if you look at the chart on the bottom left, if you look at the chart of Yes Bank, what happened over there, in July 2018, problems started surfacing around Yes Bank and their corporate governance practices. And we saw that the retail shareholding was around 15-20% in July 2018. By the time it was October and multiple problems and around Yes Bank were there, and NPA recognition had also started, retail shareholding had moved up to 40%. That is, retail shareholding in Yes Bank had more than doubled over a period of 1 year. So in financial businesses, turnaround stories don't work. Bottom fishing, especially in fraudulent stocks, eventually leads to slow death. So even though retail shareholding went up to 50% in the hope that Yes Bank will turn around, some miracle will happen, it eventually didn't. And eventually after the QIP, retail shareholding went down to the original 15-20%. Similar was the case with DHFL as well. In July 2018, when problems started surfacing, retail shareholding was again only around the 15-20% mark. However, over a period of time, it went up to 45-50%, again on the assumption that there will be some miraculous turnaround. But that usually does not happen. In most cases, it is like catching a falling knife, and retail shareholders actually end up destroying a lot of wealth for themselves. So it is always better to, first of all, identify stocks where there are questionable accounting practices. We'll get to the ratios, how we can identify such stocks. Secondly, once these stocks are identified, we'd recommend that we should stay away from them. Even though apparently it might appear that these accounting issues might not surface, but when they do, there is hardly any time to react, and there is enormous wealth destruction overnight. It does not take long for these stocks to destroy wealth. Over to you, Ashok.
So yeah, so why this topic is the most relevant today? Actually, this topic, forensic accounting, it's not that it's relevant only today. It was relevant yesterday. It will be relevant in the future. But we have used the word today primarily because of the quality, the rally that we are seeing in the last 3-4 months. There is a tendency among the investor to lose sight of the quality in a rising or the bull market. You know, that is what is happening in the last 3-4 months. So if you look at the table on the top left-hand side, the companies which have delivered the shareholders the best returns in the last 4 months, look at the median market cap and the ROC actually. So there's clearly a quality has taken a backseat in the last 3 to 4 months. And generally investors tend to lose. It's like a saying that, you know, people remember God during bad times, but they forget God during good times. So that is also analogy applies to the quality. So during a rising and bull market, seems the quality takes a backseat. The rally which we have seen in the last 3-4 months is somewhat a reminder of what happened in CY16 and CY17. You know, at that time also, the table on the top right hand side. The best performing companies were those with the mediocre ROCs actually. The problem is that such rally doesn't sustain long actually. So the tide soon turns, and at that time what happens is, like, if you look at again the CY18 and CY19 example, the company which fell the most were the companies which had risen the most in CY17 and CY18. And again, the problem is that these companies fall much more than what they have risen actually. So in net effect, that the shareholders actually get trapped in the stocks, they lose more than what they earned during good times in the stock. And hence, what we recommend, that we quality shouldn't necessarily be a tool in the bear market. Risk management shouldn't necessarily be a reactive measure. Rather, risk management quality should be perennially ingrained in the portfolio. And this is more so given the unpredictable cycles in the market that we have been seeing in the last few years, actually. So in the last 1.5 years itself, take the case of BSE Small Cap, we have seen two very, very sharp drawdowns, actually. So given this increasingly unpredictable nature of the market, this becomes all the more important that we shouldn't lose of quality at any time, basically. Whether it's the up market, whether it is a down market, quality should always be at the foremost. And this is what we do in the Marcellus also. So we never invest in stocks from a quarter perspective, which stocks will do well in this quarter or in the next 6 months. As we have spoken about this in our earlier calls also. So we look to hold stock forever, or at least a minimum period of 2 to 3 years actually. And in that period, anything can happen, right? Market can be up and down. And hence, we look at quality stocks actually. So because, again, we are looking for 2 to 3 year perspective, and hence we look at quality stocks. Quality is sort of, we very strongly believe in quality actually of the stocks. And now we'll move on to the core part of our discussion today. But before we move on to the Marcellus approach, this slide we have put up primarily to what were the key lessons that, we analyzed one more long list of companies, fraudulent companies. What are the key lessons? Because unless you know the lessons and the traits, it's becomes very difficult to design an appropriate detection methodology. So it is very important to look at the key traits and lessons from studying the fraudulent companies. So some of them, the prominent ones we have listed down in this slide. The first point is very important. The first bullet point, I think 90% of the companies actually can be detected simply by the first bullet point. The P&L of the fraudulent companies typically paints a different story compared to the balance sheet and the cash flow. And more often than not, the P&L paints a rosier picture of the company compared to the balance sheet and the cash flow statement. And it has to do with two things. First and foremost is that it is relatively easy to manipulate the profit and loss statement actually. So I think revenue recognition, aggressive revenue recognition, is one of the most abused practices used by the management to inflate the earnings. And secondly, it is also the tendency of the analyst and the investor to focus more on the income statement rather than the balance sheet and the cash flow. And hence, more often than not, you'll find that, you know, a company may look very good on the looking at its earnings per share or the margin. But when you go beyond the profit and loss account and go into balance sheet and cash flow, you will find that company doesn't seem to be what it is. So look at the net debt equity of those companies, look at the ROC of those companies, look at the free cash flow generation of the of such companies. So we'll come, you will encounter a completely different picture of the companies. So so that is the first very important point, that the P&L will tell a different story than the balance sheet and cash flow statement. The second bullet point is basically where the promoters start creating side pockets from them at the detrimental of the minority shareholders. So any companies with extensive companies in the group, or related parties, or the shareholder, the promoter shares are heavily pledged, that is a clearly red flag. It may be possible that currently the list of the related party may be long. There may not be much related party transaction, but it raises a risk that tomorrow, if these group companies are going through any kind of financial distress, it's a big red flag, because the listed company will be more likely milked by the promoters to fund the losses in the group company. So the sheer presence of a large number of group companies, related parties, is a clearly red flag in our approach. And third point is in a way linked to the second point. Again, a standalone listed company may look very beautiful, but you should look at the group companies also. And what happens is like very clear, cleverly, most of these promoters, they structure their investment. So even the listed company may be investing in these group companies, but deliberately they will structure it in such a way that those companies are not consolidated in the listed company. So primary example in the Western world, this was the Enron. You know, I believe that most of you must be aware about what happened in Enron. There were a lot of balance sheet entities which was not consolidated into Enron. Similarly, in India, around 10 years back, there is a trend among a lot of these infrastructure power companies. They used to float SPVs, special purpose vehicles, but deliberately the stake in this SPV used to be less than 50%. And the Indian accounting standard sort of allows that unless you own more than 50% in any entity, you need not consolidate that entity. So deliberately, these companies used to own a lot of SPVs. They used to keep the ownership in these SPVs below 50%. But for all practical purpose, actually, if you look the contingent liability schedule of this company, the listed company would be guaranteeing almost 100% of the debt of that SPV. So all practical purpose, it was actually taking a debt in the listed company, but there was a clever structuring. We also had an instance of very famous, reputed commercial vehicle company, which until 6 years back used to have such structure. So it used to have two entities below it, in which it owned 50%, 50% in each of these entities. And these two entities own 50% in each other. And this 50% entity used to have a long chain of loss-making investment. But because the structure of the listed company was not required to consolidate this loss-making entities into its business, and hence the standalone financials look very, very clean, very superb. But actually the group, it was actually the different picture. So look out for such complex structures actually. Tej, you want to take the other three part?
Yeah, sure. So in the case of financial companies, because the balance sheet and P&L are so closely linked, again, the most important ratio becomes whether the P&L reflects the true picture and whether the balance sheet is actually rotting or not. So in most cases where there are instances of fraud, what happens is that the P&L looks much better than it actually is, while the balance sheet may have multiple issues. That's what happened in the case of Yes Bank. That's what happened in the case of DHFL. Because of the unwillingness of most promoters to take on credit cost on the balance sheet or to upfront fee income or to upfront treasury income on the P&L, the balance sheet actually is deteriorating while the P&L does not show that true picture. So whenever the fraud actually comes to light, you see a severe hit on the P&L. And that severe hit eventually leads to a destruction of the balance sheet as well. Additionally, large number of M&A transactions or large number of fundraises, frequent fundraises, they are a clear red flag. So in the case of DHFL, for example, they did multiple buying and selling of stake sales in their JVs, in their associate companies. So DHFL, for example, had three, four associate companies. They had three, four joint ventures. They had additionally four more subsidiaries. When there are multiple transactions, whether it be M&A transaction or stake sales, that needs to be closely monitored. Similarly, the motive behind making a P&L look better the motive behind a frequent fundraise is that what the promoter would want is that his stake should not get diluted. So he would try to do a fundraise at a higher price. Secondly, what a promoter maybe would want is that he can maybe siphon off money from the company. And both of these things are interrelated. So whenever there is a fundraise, if you see that just before the fundraise that the company has reported a very, very good numbers, or just before the fundraise, a large transaction or a mini transaction has happened, which boosts the profitability of the company, that should be closely monitored. Again, another important point is whenever a company has relatives or friends or family on the board of directors, what a lot of promoters would not want is fiduciary oversight on them, whether it be by way of capable auditors or whether it be by way of independent directors. because they want to run their own sort of fiefdom without any regulatory oversight or any fiduciary oversight, they would try and appoint board of directors or CFOs or auditors, which cannot question the authority of these promoters. And that is why, if in case we see a lot of changes in auditors or CFOs, or if we see that the directors are not actually independent and they are related to the promoters in some way or the other, that is one of the softer aspects that we should look at in addition to the forensics that we do. Back to you, Ashwin.
Yeah. So now we'll move on to the Marcellus approach to detecting fraudulent companies. So as I said, the first one is the forensic accounting screen. So I'll take the non-financials part and I'll then hand over to Tej. So first and foremost, wanted to make clear that so what the resources we have at the disposal is the published financial information. So we are not the auditors of the company, so we don't have the inside information of the company. This is basically all we do on the published information on the company. So in case of non-financials, we use a set of 12 basic forensic ratios. And I'll talk about a few of them. So we use a set of 6 years of financials, preferably consolidated financials if it is available or it is applicable for the company. So we should do on the consolidated financials rather than the standalone financials. So we typically calculate the score for the universe individually on each of these ratios, and then we cumulate the score across all these 12 ratios. And finally, on the aggregate score, we rank the companies decile based. So D1 being the best and the D10 being the worst, actually. So some of the ratios which we have is shown in the table on the left side below. So the first ratio is very important. It's a basic ratio, but it is sort of the very important, most important ratio that we have, is cash flow from operation as percentage of EBITDA. This emanates from the first point which we discussed in the first bullet, that P&L paints a different picture of the company compared to the cash flow statement. So what we essentially try to do in this ratio is that we calculate how much of the operating profit is getting converted into cash flow from operations. Because as I said, like, it's relatively easy to manipulate the reported earnings. So revenue recognition, a company may aggressively recognize revenue. What will happen is that the earnings will look good for that companies. But the what will happen on the balance sheet side is that because it is not a genuine revenue transaction, so the working capital will bloat for such companies. In other words, the cash flow from operation will look relatively small compared to the operating profit. So our model punishes companies where the cash flow from operation, so we take cumulative 6 years, both numerator and denominator. And cash flow from operation we take before tax for an apple to apple, because we are comparing it with EBITDA, which is before tax. So cash flow from operation should also be taken before tax. So we compare this ratio, and our model punishes the companies which have very low ratios. So typically you will find that the EPC companies, the infrastructure companies, real estate companies, they will typically fall very low in this ratio, actually, because there is a subjectivity involved in the revenue recognition in these companies. Like, for example, real estate, how much is the percentage of completion? Obviously, it's a subjective call. So you'll find that typically these kind of sectors, they fall, they get very low score in these ratios. Similarly, the second ratio which we have is provisioning for debtors. So again, we combine this with the debtor days. For example, the companies where the debtor days is very small, no, even if the provisioning for debtor is very small, we don't mind it, because the overall debtor itself is very small compared to the overall balance sheet. So we combine this provisioning for debtors with the debtor days. And we punish companies where the provisioning for debtor is very low compared to the peers. Third is an interesting ratio, yield on cash and cash equivalents. So what we compare is that how much of the cash that you are showing in the balance sheet, what is the income that is getting realized again that cash in the profit and loss account. So if the yield is very low, for example, say it's only 1 or 2%, it raises serious concern about whether the cash actually exists in the balance sheet. So just I'm recollecting Satyam's case here. So whether the cash actually really exists in the balance sheet, if the yield is 1 and 2%, I think it raises a serious concern. Or it may be case that during the year end, the company is actually showing the cash, but during the interim period, that cash is actually moving out of the company. So it may be possible that that cash is getting diverted into promoter's own entities, while at the year end, he's smart enough to bring that cash on the balance sheet. So this ratio detects such kind of accounting malpractices. The fourth is very simple: contingent liabilities as percentage of net worth. So as I said, like, we should be very should be cautious about the off-balance sheet liabilities. And here we not only look at the disputed liabilities like tax demands from the government, income tax, etc., but we also consider the guarantees given, particularly on behalf of the third parties. For example, there may be a group companies. So if the listed company is giving a big guarantee to banks on behalf of those group companies, so we also capture that thing in this fourth ratio, contingent liabilities. And fifth ratio is CWIP, capital work in progress to gross block. So idea for taking this ratio is that it is relatively, again, easy to manipulate your capital work in progress. For example, an auditor can't audit actually a capital work in progress, right? There is nothing to physically verify. At least in the case of fixed assets, you can physically verify the fixed assets. But in case of capital work in progress, you actually, an auditor can't verify a capital work in progress. So largely it is dependent on the management, what inputs the management give based on management judgment, etc. So it's a very, very sort of a easy thing to manipulate, capital work in progress. Similarly, on capital work in progress, you don't have to charge depreciation. So the depreciation charge starts only when an asset is capitalized. So long as it is work in progress, you don't need to have any amortization on the depreciation on this capital work in progress. And hence, we punish companies where the capital work in progress as percentage of gross block is very high. Those companies get punished in our forensic model. The sixth is very simple, free cash flow. In a way, it is related to the first ratio. If the company is not generating free cash flow, again, capex is one of the easy way to pilfer out money. So a company may be putting out only, say, 100 ton capacity in actual, but in books, they will show that they are putting up 500 ton capacity. So what is the difference is 400, it is basically pilfered out of the company. So we punish companies which are perennially negative free cash flow. And very interestingly, almost 25% of the BSE 500, they have not generated positive free cash flow in the last 6 years, actually. It's a very big number. 25% of the BSE 500 companies have not generated positive free cash flow in the last 6 years. And the last ratio is, again, very interesting. What we calculate is the growth in the auditor remuneration to the growth in the revenues. And we punish companies where the numerator is significantly higher than the denominator. Because it raises question that if the company's revenues are not growing, its operation is not growing, and hence the work of the auditor is not growing. But if the auditor fees is increasing every year, it raises a serious concern. You know, why are you paying the auditor more and more every year when his work is actually not increasing? So then it raises question marks around the independence and the objectivity of the auditors, actually. And we punish companies, actually. And this is especially relevant in case of the small caps, because in case of small caps, actually, when you look at the name of the auditor, it is very obscure, actually. So unknown auditor, this ratio comes very handy, particularly in the case of small caps. So these were the seven ratio for non-financials. So before I hand over the stage, some of you may have some questions that, you know, typically the sectors like infrastructure, real estate, they will naturally get punished because of the ratios which we are using. But obviously, we are not here, like, we don't sector agnostic, any sector which performs poorly because of these ratios, so we will never touch it, be it real estate. But surprisingly, actually, many of the consumer names, even auto ancillaries, we will have that a large mix of those companies fall in the lower decile. So it is not that only the bad sectors, the typical because of the business model, the real estate structure or the infrastructure come in then, but even within consumer, auto ancillaries, you'll find that there are a lot of companies which fall in the lower end of our forensic model. So for non-financials, we typically eliminate the bottom 40% of the companies. So whatever companies fall in decile 7 to decile 10, straight away we eliminate those companies in this stage. Over to you, Tej.
Yeah. For financial companies, we use 11 ratios. Again, we use the historical financials of the last 6 years based on the annual reports of these companies. And basis these 6 years of financial ratios, we eventually arrive at a ranking. Out of the 11 ratios, we've shown about 7 ratios for financials over here. The first one being interest accrued as a percentage of interest income. So what happens in a lot of financial companies, if you have a large component of interest accrued, this is similar to cash flow conversion in case of non-financial companies. If you have a large proportion of interest accrued, those companies are getting punished by our financial forensics model, or by our accounting screen. What these companies can do is these financial companies can issue loans which are long dated. That is, these companies can have repayment schedules which are, say, a bullet repayment at the end of 3 years, 4 years, or 5 years. Because of which, these companies might book upfront income. So interest might also get accrued. It will be reflected on the P&L as well. But there is a higher risk on the balance sheet because of that. Therefore, companies which have a higher interest accrued relative to their peers is getting punished on our forensic score. The second ratio is treasury income as a percentage of net interest income. This is pretty important because most financial companies have a high amount of treasury income compared to non-financial companies. So if a financial company has more than 5% of its net interest income from treasury income, that is a red flag for us. Because companies can easily switch from or classify investments from, say, held to maturity to available for sale. If in case companies hold investments as HTM, they are not required to take mark-to-market gains or losses. So depending on how the investment book is performing, companies or management teams can decide how to classify investments. And this is pretty easy for companies to boost up their P&L, make their P&L look better in the quarter that they would want to, basis the classification of their treasury book. Therefore, anywhere we see that a large amount of P&L income is coming from treasury investments, that is where these financial companies get punished. Fee income as a percentage of net interest income is the third ratio. This is especially for lenders which do wholesale lending or have a large corporate book. So wherever we see that fee income is a large proportion, especially in lenders which have a large corporate book, that is a red flag. What happens is in the lure to grow your balance sheet quickly, just because some management teams may want to grow their loan book quickly, they can lend out to large corporates, give out chunky loans, and take 3, 4, 5% of the loan as processing fee or upfront fee income. While the balance sheet will grow, while the loan book will grow, the company may see a large amount of NPAs in the future. So a large chunky loan with 3, 4% of upfront fee income will boost up the P&L in that year, will boost up the P&L in that quarter. However, 3, 4 years out, when the exposure becomes risky, or when the corporate to whom the company has lent just for the 3-4% upfront fee income is facing trouble, that is where we might see a large NPA exposure on the company's balance sheet. The fourth ratio is NPA volatility. So wherever there is a high amount of volatility in the NPA ratios, especially not in the case of NBFCs, where we see that ECL provisioning is mandated. That is, apart from what was earlier as 30 DPD, 60 DPD, or 90 DPD. Now, provisioning is done based on your own estimates. When we see that NPA volatility is higher, because it is based on judgment now, rather than a clear rule-based mechanism, that is where NBFCs and banks get punished on our forensic score. Fifth is provisioning as a percentage of NPA. Over here, what usually happens is, again, to boost up the P&L, to make the profit margins, ROEs look better, companies might provide for an amount which is lower than what is actually required. So now, under the ECL mechanism, what companies are actually required to do is provide for basis their best estimates. These estimates are calculated on the basis of probability of default, loss given default, and exposure at the time of default. It is a multiplication actually of these three factors, whatever the provision should be for NBFCs. And probability of default is a number computed by management teams. It is the best estimate of the management team. Given that this is a number determined by the management team, they might provide for lower than what is required for just to make the P&L look much better. And we might see a large amount of provisioning coming in whenever the asset is written off. So provision as a percentage of NPA, wherever it is higher, it is better. where if we see that the number is lower compared to its peers, such companies get pushed back in our forensic score. Finally, the last two ratios are very similar to non-financial companies. Contingent liabilities to net worth in case of financial companies. These contingent liabilities also include off-balance sheet sort of loans which have been given, guarantees which have been given. It also includes forward rate agreements and derivatives which these banks or NBFCs have entered into. So typically this number is, because of the business model of these companies, anyways higher, but because we are comparing peers to peers, we can easily check where which bank or NBFC is standing out versus its peer banks or NBFCs. The last ratio is very similar to non-financial companies. Over to you, Ashwin.
So that was our first level of forensic check. So that was a quantitative screen. But as I said in the beginning, actually, both the forensic screen, quantitative screen, as well as we have the capital allocation quantitative screen, they significantly crunch the universe to a very small subset. So typically 5% of the overall universe is remaining. So that is our researchable universe. So it's a narrow subset, but now we go into in-depth actually in these companies. So we look at typically 10 to 15 years of annual reports of financial statements for these companies. And there are many things actually on this slide, but I will touch upon 3 to 4 things. So my personal favorite is the comparative common size income statement versus peers. So what we do is that we compare, we break down the P&L as much detail as possible, each and every expense line item. And we compare as a percentage of revenue for each and every line item, expense line item, with that of the peers, median for the peers. And if it is significantly divergent for this company, we should understand the reason. Is it justified? Because, for example, if it is much higher than the median for the peers, it should be justified by either this company has a very large scale compared to the peers, or its product mix is substantially superior compared to the peers. If we find that the scale is somewhat similar or the product mix there is not significant different, then it raises a question mark. Either why this company is generating such superior margin versus the peers, or in case it is generating significantly lower that margin than the peers, again, we need to question mark actually. So we do an in-depth common size income statement analysis of the company versus the peers. And it helps actually answer a lot of questions about the company actually. So not only about forensic, actually we also understand more about the company's business model, etc. And similar to this is the comparative DuPont analysis. So DuPont is nothing but your margin into your asset turn. So here we focus more on the balance sheet basically. So again, similar to the income statement, we focus, is the gross block turnover of the company significantly different from the peers? Is the working capital days of the company significantly different from the peers? And mind you, we are talking about median for the peers. We're not talking about one or two peers actually, because it may be possible that the other company may be fraudulent. So we are talking about a median for a larger set of peers. And if the gross block turnover is substantially lower compared to the peers, where the working capital days is significantly higher than the peers, then it raises a serious question mark about these items for these companies. So we get into the depth of this the divergence actually. And one more I'll pick up from this slide is very interesting is we'll find in India that a lot of auditor consolidated the audit report on the consolidated financial statements will find a comment that a significant portion of the company's operations are not audited by the principal statutory auditor. So while it may be genuine in some of the cases, for example, a big four, typically KPMG in India is auditing the Indian financial statements, and the overseas subsidiaries may be audited by an affiliate of KPMG. In technically speaking, it's a different entity, even though it falls under the overall KPMG group global, but technically it is a different different entity. But in most of the cases, actually, this turns is not the case basically. So you'll find that the standalone financials are audited by a reputed auditor, but most of the subsidiaries, and though there'll be substantial part of the company's businesses in those entities, subsidiaries or associates or joint ventures, they are audited by the obscure auditors, basically unknown auditors. And the principal auditor doesn't, is his responsibility is absolute, right? He's not commenting on the audit reports of the subsidiaries or the JVs are issued by a different auditor. So he doesn't have to comment on their actually audit statement, and hence he is absolved of his responsibility. So you'll find that in India, you'll find such many, many cases, almost 50-60% of the company's operations being audited by the auditor other than the principal auditor of the company. So that is a clear red flag actually. So we had this pharma company 6-7 years back, where substantial portion of a reputed pharma company, where substantial portion of its operations were audited by other than the principal statutory auditor of the company. And the other things on the right side are more of the corporate governance checks. So related party transaction. One is the number of related parties very high. Secondly, whether the transaction with those related parties are very high. The other business interest of the promoters, you know. So when you have a lot of companies in the group, so you should not only focus on the financials of the listed company, actually you should download the financials of these group companies. If they are private companies, you should download from the MCA website. So we pay equal attention to the financials of the group companies. So if there is any, if these group companies are going through any form of stress, it is clearly a red flag actually. And similarly, merger and acquisitions of the promoter-owned entity, in a way it is related to the earlier point. So what typically, if the group entity is going through any form of distress, all the possibility of funding is close to that entity, what typically the promoters do is that they merge that entity with the listed companies actually. And again, it's detrimental to the interest of the minority shareholders of the listed company. Similarly, if there is significant litigation surrounding the promoters, the promoters are indulging into insider buying and selling, particularly before any sensitive event, like before the results are declared, they indulge into any significant buying or selling, that is clearly a red flag. Similarly, remuneration to promoters. So we don't mind promoters paying themselves good, but it should be reasonable when compared to the profitability of the company. So in a year when the company is not making any profits and the promoters are still drawing significantly higher remuneration, it is not a good governance practice. Similarly, if the remuneration to the promoters significantly exceed the dividend that is getting paid to the minority shareholders, again, that is not the best of the corporate governance practice. You know, so we pay attention to these aspects. And again, as Tej touched upon, any company which is engaging in, basically any company which is the favorite of the investment bankers, we don't like those companies. Whether those companies are frequently engaging into M&A or they are frequently engaging into equity dilution, that is clearly a red flag. And we try as much as possible to stay away from those companies. So this was the second level check, and we'll move on to the last but an important part of our forensic check. Tej, you want to take this?
Yeah, sure. So after doing the first step, that is eliminating companies which are in the bottom 3-4 deciles, that is eliminating about 30-40% of the universe, what we also try and do is corroborate what the red flags we've identified by way of our quantitative filters. We try and corroborate that by way of speaking to our primary data sources and also speaking to people who are related to the company. When we do this, apart from identifying what the strengths of the company are or what the weaknesses in the business model are, what we also try and do is we try and corroborate whether the integrity of the management is there or not. How good is the management in terms of dealing with suppliers, distributors, dealers, ex-employees. Wherever we find, for example, when we use 11-12 ratios, there might be some or the other ratio where we might get a red flag. Even though the company might be a D4 or a D5 or a D6, there might be a couple of ratios where we might feel that here is where we might need to do more work. And for example, if in the case of financial companies, we see that fee income as a percentage of interest income is pretty high, we go and speak to DSAs and we inquire about the lender's practices, whether the lender indulges in giving out loans, for example, just because he'll be able to earn a higher fee income for that quarter. Similarly, when we see a low amount of provisioning, we go and speak to the credit officer of the lender and we inquire whether the lower provisioning, is it because there will be eventually lower loss given default, or Is it because the lender is trying to make its P&L look better? So these are judgment calls. These are calls on qualitative aspects, which we are able to take in a much better way because we are doing these extensive due diligence checks. So for example, in the case of lenders, especially when we go and visit branches or speak to credit officers or DSAs or collection agents, we are able to know a lot more about the lending practices of these companies. When we ask, say, simple questions around whether the sales manager or whether the branch officer, is he incentivized by way of disbursements? Is his target based on disbursements, or is his target also linked to collections? That is a very simple way to analyze what the company is focusing on. Is it a shorter view of things? Is it a focus on the P&L? Or is it a much more longer term view of things? Is it a focus on the balance sheet, long-term profitability, credit quality, etc.? So in most high quality lenders, what we see is that the salesperson is actively involved not only in giving out the loan, building the relationship with the customer, but is also actively involved in the collections as well. Also, the branch officer is not only given targets around disbursement, but is also given targets around collections, asset quality as well. Also, in most cases where we see that employees have a higher amount of variable pay linked to the performance rather than giving a higher amount of fixed pay, we see those are companies which have in the long term better performance, better asset quality as well. Similarly, speaking to third parties, people who know the management well, especially in the case of small caps and in the case of financial companies, we are able to judge the integrity of the management and the intentions of the management. What is the management trying to do? Is he trying to build a really sustainable long-term business which will create wealth not only for the management and the promoter, but also for the minority shareholders or not? So those are the few things that we as a part of the research team, now we have a 10-11 people research team, we try and analyze apart from doing the quantitative work. So in the research team, now we have a team of 8-9 CAs and CFAs. For instance, Ashwin and I, both of us are CAs. Both of us have a CFA degree as well. And we have focused on building these quantitative models, building these forensic models for a long period of time. So every year these models get updated. We try and figure out more and more ratios, how we can improve upon these models and how we can build these models in a much better way so that we can identify companies well in advance, companies which are poor quality accounting well in advance. Similarly, it is the same team of people who do the primary data checks, the same team of people who do the forensic checks, because they have insight into the numbers, go and do the primary data checks as well. And over the past 10 years, we've done about 1,000 bespoke accounting projects for institutional investors. So Ashwin and I were both a part of the Ambit team. Saurabh, Pramod, Rakshit, all of them have been working together for 12, 13 years. Since a long period of time, our focus has been on accounting quality, identifying companies which are poor quality accounting. Over to you, Ashwin.
Yeah. So I just want to stress upon two points here that obviously there is a technical competence and there is a process, but also more importantly, we are committed and disciplined about that process actually. So any stock that we write on a document, it has to, so we rigorously follow the accounting checklist. So that is a necessary part of the stock write-up actually. So how did the each and every that quantitative screen as well as the checklist which we shared in the last two slides. We write the comments against those points for each and every company. So it is rigorously and very committedly followed by the research team. And also as Tej highlighted that we come with a lot of experience because you'll find that most of the companies, they are not 100% black or 100% white. Most of them have the shades of gray. So sometimes, or rather actually most of the times you have to take a judgment call actually, you know, there is an issue before you. You need to take a judgment call whether it is material or not material, significant or not significant. So that is where our experience comes. So we have been doing this, I think more than researching on the company from a business model perspective, we have done more forensic bespoke projects actually. So I think that experience actually helps us in forming that judgment, you know, and making that final decision as regards the forensic part. We'll now move on to specific two case studies. So one is the financials, which Tej will start with. Tej?
Sure. So we're over here discussing the case of DHFL. And we did a forensics for DHFL, like we do run our forensic model every year. We did it over FY 16, 17, 18 for DHFL because it was a part of our NBFC housing finance universe. We used 11 ratios like we discussed earlier, and there were primarily three red flags in the case of DHFL that we came across. One was fee income as a percentage of net interest income for DHFL was pretty high. So if you look at the chart at the bottom left, it was actually increasing year over year. It was 10% in FY 16. And it went to as high as 25% in FY 18 for DHFL. When we compared DHFL to its housing finance peers, it came to light that it was the second worst when it came to this metric, as in its fee income was the second highest amongst the housing finance peers. And when we took a six-year median, so we take a six-year median for all our ratios so that we can avoid one-offs in accounting, in terms of accounting, or maybe there is an exceptional item, so we can avoid them. But DHFL across these 6 years on a median basis as well stood out when it came to fee income as a percentage of net interest income. And in our forensic score, DHFL was second only to Reliance Home Finance. So like we discussed, what a lot of lenders can do when it comes to fee income is that wherever there are bulky loans, wherever there are chunky loans, large amounts of corporate loans or large amount of developer loans in the case of DHFL can be given out for say 3-5% of the loan being taken upfront as fee income. That will be recorded on the P&L while the loan will go on the balance sheet, and the lender will be able to report higher loan book growth. As a result of that, the P&L for that quarter or maybe that year will look better. However, 3-5 years out, the risk which the lender would have taken to book that upfront fee income may turn out to be bad for the minority shareholders. So while they were able to book a good amount of profit on the P&L, while they were also able to book large amounts of loan book growth, when that developer loan or when that corporate loan blows up, that is when the balance sheet will come under stress. So that is on the first red flag. Fee income being high was a red flag for us. The second red flag was treasury income as a percentage of net interest income. Again, on this metric, DHFL ranked the third worst on our financial score. This is again on a median basis, median of 6 years, the 6 years being FY 13 to FY 18. So this was before DHFL's credit rating dropped from AAA to D. Actually, that also is a story in itself. So like we discussed, once this accounting fraud comes to light, minority shareholders do not get a lot of time to correct their mistake. So DHFL was rated AAA in January of 2018 or 2019. By June, in a period of 6 months, it was rated D by all rating agencies. So this is a value destruction in a period of 6 months. So on treasury income, what a lot of lenders can do is, because L2 maturity securities do not have to have mark to market in case there are losses or in case there are profits. There are no mark to market gains or mark to market losses in case of L2 maturity securities. While if you have HFT or available for sale securities, you will have to mark them down. Therefore, basis this, depending on how your investment pool is behaving, lenders will classify them as maybe held to maturity or held for trading or available for sale in that particular quarter. In case the security is performing well, it will not be classified as held to maturity. Therefore, you will be able to book mark-to-market gains. However, if the security is not performing well, there are losses, you'll book it as or classify it as a held to maturity security. Now, in the case of DHFL, 30% of its net interest income came as treasury income, which for most other housing finance companies was anywhere between 10 to 15%. Therefore, this was the second red flag for us. The third red flag in the case of DHFL was change in reserves as a percentage of profitability. So what we do is that PAT minus all appropriations like preference dividend or dividend payouts is compared to the change in reserves, because naturally PAT minus appropriations should be added to the reserves and surplus on the balance sheet. In case that number is not 100%, in case that number does not match, we try and evaluate why the number is not matching. So in the case of DHFL, the reason it was not matching was because there were large amounts of zero coupon bonds and NCDs. The interest on these bonds and NCDs was being set off against reserves and surplus and against securities premium. As a result of this, these two numbers did not match. So what happens is if you set off this interest expense against the balance sheet, you are not taking a hit on the P&L. So actually your interest margins, net interest margins, your ROEs are looking much better than they actually are. These numbers are inflated and therefore you have to adjust for these numbers. Also, what we see on the chart on the top right is that over a period of time, DHFL was booking more and more chunky loans. So if you look at project loans, they moved from 5% of the loan book in FY13 to 15% in FY18. That, along with the rise in fee income as a percentage of net interest income, when we corroborate these two things, that is when we realize that it is best that as investors, we should stay away from a lender like this. So that is our take on DHFL, how even before FY19, based on the forensics, we can identify lenders who have poor quality accounting. Over to you, Ashwin.
So this is a case study on Amtek Auto. So very simply put, actually, as we said earlier, the Amtek's P&L look much more glossier compared to its balance sheet and cash flow. The P&L was so good that it was the cheapest auto ancillary stock actually. So earnings was so, margins were so high, earnings so good. But when you look at the balance sheet and the cash flow statement, they told a different story. So gross block turnover extremely low compared to the peers, working capital days significantly higher compared to the peers. And the company's free cash flow generation, there's no free cash flow generation except for 1 year in a span of 12 years, actually. So in other words, they had generated positive free cash flow in only one of the 12 years between June 2014, actually. So we dwelled deeper into the accounts of Amtek Auto. So we compared the components of its P&L with the peers. So clearly there were red flags, actually. So its standalone, particularly standalone margin was very high actually. So not in some years it exceeded 30%, which is actually unusual for an auto ancillary company. And clearly we didn't find any difference in the scale of Amtek Auto or its product mix compared to the peers. And hence there was a clear red flag in the margins that they reported. Also, the depreciation rate, depreciation charge for the company was relatively low. And this was particularly confounding given the lower gross block turnover of the company. As you know, on the balance sheet, there were a lot of questions. The working capital days were significantly higher compared to the peers. Gross block turnover has actually never exceeded more than 1x actually for Amtek Auto in any of these years. So again, clearly red flags on the balance sheet. On the cash flow, as I said, like there was only 1 year of positive free cash flow generation. So obviously, to some extent, it was because Amtek was group was making one acquisition every couple of years. But even sans acquisition, even from if you remove acquisitions, I think the free cash flow profile wouldn't have changed actually. So even organically, they were not generating positive free cash flow generation. So clearly, a big red flag on the cash flow statement. Similarly, on the corporate governance aspect, there were several questions like Amtek had another 3-4 listed companies besides Amtek Auto. And honestly speaking, despite being an auto analyst, I couldn't figure the difference in the product. There are a lot of product between these four companies. There are a lot of overlap in the products of these four companies. In a way, it created a very difficult situation for the minority shareholders for these companies. So there is no clear demarcation. So there is a conflict of interest between the minority shareholders of these listed companies. And surprisingly, glaring error, there was no related party transaction disclosure in the consolidated financial statements, where the consolidated financial statement contained the list of the related parties, but where there was no disclosure of the transactions with this real estate, related parties. Actually, clearly a big lapse on their reporting front. And finally, we also couldn't get comfort from the auditor. It was audited by a relatively small side Delhi-based auditor. But more importantly, the auditor has been similar for many years. So 2002, the earliest year that the earliest annual report that we could get hold of Amtech Auto, it had a similar auditor in 2002 till 2014. So we analyzed this company in 2014. Clearly, there were many red flags in this company, and we decided that we will not do more work on this company. And obviously, everybody knows that what happened in subsequent years, actually. So clearly, from 16, 17 onwards, they started. So from robust profit, they started reporting actually losses in, I think, 16, 17 onwards. So clearly, we were able to detect this much ahead of the market. So we will stop here. Actually, we'll take the Q&A. Just a request that given that this is a sensitive topic, we will not be able to comment on the individual stock names, except for that forming part of our portfolio.
Well, I think we've got some really interesting questions on the ratios you and Tej have highlighted. Okay. So given that it is a forensic accounting session, I'll highlight some of the most interesting accounting questions that have come up, right? So I think there's a group of questions around, if you could just explain more clearly, what exactly is CWIP, right? What exactly is CWIP? How, and therefore, when you look at CWIP, what is gross block? And when you look at CWIP to gross block, what is high, what is low? Well, you know, to your opinion, in your opinion, what is a high CWIP to gross block? What is a low CWIP to gross block? I think there's a bunch of interesting questions. You could take that, Ashwin.
So capital work in progress is basically any asset is under construction, particularly say you're constructing a building or a infrastructure, not much in the case of furniture or machinery, because those are need not be constructed, but particularly in the case of the building and infrastructure, it takes time actually. So till the building is ready or the infrastructure is ready, the Companies Act doesn't permit the capitalization of such assets. Only it is actually it can be commercially put to use. Does the accounting standard and the company set allow the capitalization of that assets? So obviously, because it is a work in progress, it is not a physical asset in place. So it becomes difficult for an auditor to physically verify. So, but you see, in case of other assets which are capitalized, at least he can physically go to the building and see and whether it is worth the amount that is being shown in the financial statement. In case of capital work in progress, actually there is very little that anybody can do except for relying on the management estimates actually of those assets. Clearly there is scope for inflating that capital work in progress. There is scope as well as there is a ability to inflate the capital work in progress. And obviously, there is no any absolute threshold. This is on relative basis. We rank the companies on a relative basis. So there is no any absolute threshold that this number, if the company exceeds, or the CWIP to gross block is lower than this number, the company is good. If it is excluding, it's higher than this number, it is bad. But generally speaking, I think the median in our universe would be typically 15 to 20%. So any company which has more than 20% of capital work in progress, I think clearly there is some issue surrounding the capital work in progress that they are reporting.
Okay. So one for Tej. This is a nice question on, shouldn't treasury income be taken as a percentage of total income? And in brackets, the person has defined total income as NII plus other income. So shouldn't treasury income be taken as a percentage of total income?
Right. So, because what we do is we take net interest income because that is the core earnings of a bank or an NBFC. Net interest income calculated as in by interest income subtracted by interest expense. So, interest income is derived by way of interest on all interest-bearing bearing assets, and interest expense is derived by way of interest expense on all interest-bearing liabilities. Because this is the core business of a bank or NBFC, to lend money and to lend money on the basis of the liabilities that you've raised, we take only net interest income as our denominator and not other income in the denominator. So other income can include, apart from treasury income, say commissions or fees, which can be a one-off or which might vary from quarter to quarter or from a year-to-year basis. Therefore, we take it on a net interest income basis, and we take it on a net interest income basis for all companies. So when we are comparing housing finance companies or NBFCs or banks. We do it on a net interest income basis for all companies. And that is why it is an apple to apple comparison. If we were to do it on total income, that is include other income as well, there will be a lot of incomparability because other income for companies will be different basis the different segments that they are into. For example, other income might include commission, might include fee income, might include treasury income itself. And therefore, it is better to remove as much subjectivity as we can and do it on a comparable basis. So that is why we use net interest income rather than total income in the denominator.
So one more for Ashwin. Ashwin, how do you distinguish between what is good accounting and bad accounting versus good capital allocation and bad capital allocation? Where does accounting quality stop and where does analysis of capital allocation begin?
So it's there is a great degree of overlap between accounting quality and capital allocation. I would say, like, for example, capital work in progress is an example of a high degree of capital work in progress as percentage of gross block is an example of an accounting irregularity. Whereas if the fixed assets overall is very high commensurate to the size of the business, that may be an example of a missed capital allocation. But the point is that both go hand in hand, actually. So capital allocation, if a company is perennially misfiring on capital allocation, the bottom line is that it is, again, detrimental to the minority shareholders. So if it is a one-time thing, you can say that the company went wrong. But if time and again the company is misfiring on capital misallocation, it is not generating free cash flow, and most of those capital allocation are not generating returns. So again, the bottom line is that the impact is similar to that of an accounting irregularity. That is, both are shortchanging the minority shareholders.
So Tej, a question on contingent liabilities. So the question is asking, how do you know what the real contingent liabilities are? Now, the company can declare something in the annual report. The real contingent liabilities might be larger. So how do you know what the real contingent liabilities are when you try to estimate off balance sheet liabilities?
Yeah. First of all, the amount of contingent liabilities that we take in the case of banks and NBFCs, they are a combination of mostly three things. The largest proportion being derivative contracts that these banks have entered into. The second being similar to non-financial companies. There are, in some cases, in most cases, guarantees which these banks or NBFCs would have given for other joint ventures or associates or subsidiaries that they have, which usually are financial companies. Because there'll be financial companies, there'll be a higher proportion of these guarantees. And the third one being all sorts of off-balance sheet liabilities, in the sense that wherever they have lent to companies and have, it's a part of their loan book, but it is a contingent liability in the sense that it is maybe an LC. So these are the three types of contingent liabilities in the case of financial companies. Now, in addition to whatever is disclosed by the management in their annual report, the only way that we can find out anything more is by way of doing primary data checks, which is the third layer that we spoke about. That is, when we speak to DSAs or when we speak to credit managers, we try and ask them what is the typical sort of lending that happens, what are their scorecards consisting of, what are their incentives linked to, where does the management focus on, is it on disbursements or is it on asset quality or collection. So wherever management is not disclosing any additional or contingent liabilities, we do primary data checks. And secondly, in the case of a lot of promoters, there are entities where they are directors. They might be unlisted companies. They might be companies which are unlisted subsidiaries, maybe. So we try and find out what are the linkages of the promoters to these entities by way of accessing data on MCA. Those are the two sorts of checks in addition to whatever is disclosed in the annual report that we can do. That is group companies, promoters, maybe where they are directors or where they are related, and thirdly, primary data checks.
Ashwin, a group of questions around the cash yield ratio that you highlighted.
Yeah.
So basically, people are trying to, one group of people are saying, well, if a company can misrepresent cash on the balance sheet, can't they misrepresent interest income on cash on the P&L as well? That's one sort of concerns. The second is people are just trying to understand how did you, what do you mean by cash yield? How do you calculate it?
So the cash yield in the denominator part first. So we take the pure cash, which is generally very low proportion, cash, then cash lying in the bank, and then the treasury investment. So what happens is that you should also be careful that some of this mutual fund investments get classified under long-term investment. So make sure that you are taking out those, including those mutual fund, for example, liquid investments that are getting classified under long-term investment to the denominator. So that is a denominator. And obviously on the income part, you should look at the other income schedule in the profit and loss account. So you should take the dividend on income on such investments, then interest income on such investment. And there would be the profit and loss also when these current investments are sold. There will be profit loss on. So that should also be included in the numerator plus the interest that you earn on the bank balance basically. So that is the numerator. So the cash yield is simply this numerator divided by the denominator. And on the first question is so very difficult actually. So what we are trying to, obviously it's a subjective call that a company which can manipulate the balance sheet can also manipulate the cash yield. So one way you can identify is that look at the interest income volatility over the years. Volatility. If the interest income is going up and down significantly, that can be a giveaway actually. So I agree that it is possible to manipulate even the numerator actually. When you are capable of doing the denominator, you can also manipulate the numerator. But one way of checking is also to look at the volatility in the, in fact, that is also one of the ratios. We not put it out in this slide. So we also check the volatility in the non-operating income actually. So possibly that can help you to identify such practice.
Okay. So folks, a lot of you have said that you can't afford to invest with Marcellus because since we're a SEBI PMS, 50 lakhs is the minimum. So obviously, disobey the regulator. The regulator has been very clear that 50 lakhs is the minimum for a PMS corpus. What you might want to do if you like what we do is our website contains all our research, all our webinars, our newsletters are very clear about what stocks we invest in. So for example, the latest Little Champs newsletter, the small cap portfolio where Ashwin is the portfolio manager, the latest Little Champs newsletter gives the entire portfolio there. Similarly, the Consistent Compounders newsletter give away the names of most of our stocks. If you are interested in investing, our website will give you most of our intellectual property. There is no charge. Go there. You can download the stuff free of charge. For those of you want the recording, yes, this recording, the slides, the experts' views that you heard will be loaded up on our website. And with that, I think we'd like to thank you for your time. Thank you for listening to us. Thank you for the very interesting questions. Thanks a lot. Thanks, Ashwin.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you.